Now today, I want us to take time to talk about really what I'm calling what a mighty God we serve. You know, several Psalms proclaim the goodness of God and the kindness of God, but in Psalm 139, I think it's so beautiful. There are 24 verses in it. What we're going to look at today is six specific verses within the psalm, only six of them. Begin Psalm 139, beginning in verse 13. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body. He's talking about God. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Look at it, church. God did this. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. It makes you look at abortion differently, doesn't it? You saw me before I was born. I wonder where the Christians are who... Oh, well, let me stay on target here. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Whether I ever was able to express my life here or not. Huh. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. And when I wake up, you're still with me. Wow. David is the biographer sort of God. He admires what God has done. And it's obvious that David's God was not a small God, church. David understood that God is all-powerful and universally present at all time. There was a book written years ago that says your God is too small. That's absolutely the truth. You and I can't even comprehend the greatness and the magnitude of God. But David's God was not small. He was very big, magnificent, and all-encompassing. He saw him in anything and everything, and it's my prayer that today that you and I, through this message, will see God bigger than you have ever before seen him. You'll let him be a part of your life like you've never before let him be a part of your life, and that you will understand that he's so big, and you will be overwhelmed by the love that he has for you, and you will think no matter where you may be walking, what may be going on with you, you'll have this, my God will take care of me. Amen. So he's going to walk through everything with you. Right. He's going to help you in every situation. Right. He's going to be there. And he loves it when you acknowledge that he's there. Yes. So David made three observations in verses 13 and 14. Number one, God's work is marvelous. Look at verses 13 and 14. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body. You knit me together in my mother's womb. You got it, church? Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. Now, I want you to understand something. David's not thinking right here of God's knowledge, and he's not thinking about God's presence. He's talking about God's creative power here. And I want you to see it. When you start talking about the power of God, he's not looking at the oceans. He's not looking at the mountains. He's not looking at the valleys. He's not looking at the brilliance of the stars. He is standing in awe of God's creative power. Do you know the greatest creation God ever made? You. He's looking inward. He focuses on the fascinating details, actually, of the human body. He's looking at himself. On another occasion, David glorified God about the earth's creation. He said in Psalms 19, the heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display their craftsmanship. But this time, David stands amazed at God's crowning creation. The greatest of everything he did. Human beings. You are God's crowning creation. Of everything that God created, you and I are the only ones that are created in his image. Nothing else. Genesis 1:27. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God he created them. Get it? Male and female.
Right.
He created them. You know what? You may love your dog, you may love your cat, but that's not God's crowning creation. It may be the sweetest and the most wonderful little animal you ever had in your whole life. I know mine is. But he's still not God's best work. Nor is anything else. There's no natural beauty anywhere of anything ever created that's more outstanding than you are. That's what God is saying. Now, let's get things straight so you really get this today. We're talking about not the body. We're talking about the spirit and soul. The body's here for a ride. The spirit and soul returns to God.
Amen.
The body is here for this time that you are here. Yep. But the spirit and soul should be developing and even getting more and more like God, if I can say it that way. Yeah. Thinking like him, feeling like him, understanding like him. And so you may be there looking at someone that doesn't look so hot on the outside, and they absolutely could be more in the image of God than you are.
Well.
Because it's who they are on the inside. It's the spirit inside. It's how they relate. It's how they see themselves in their likeness to God. God's best work. Crowning creation. Made in his image. Likeness. Resemblance. My goodness. Jesus is the exact image of God. But we're right there. He says, if you'll just move off and let me live inside of you, you then will become this image of God that no one can resist. Because if you actually know Jesus, really know him, you can't resist him. The second thing about verses 13 through 14 is that God's work is perfect. First, it was marvelous. Second, it's perfect. David stands amazed at the reality that how powerful and outstanding God is. He's not weak. God doesn't get tired. He never stops to take a nap. And he never forgets what he meant to do. Like most of us do. But you got to remember, some of you would say, Pastor, the Bible says he had to rest on the seventh day he rested. It wasn't because he was tired. God didn't rest because he was tired. He rested because it was done. He had finished his creation. He created everything in its initial form with the potential to develop into its fullest expression. So before the world began, God made you, seed form, put in you everything he knew you could be. And it was perfect. Do you realize that if Adam and Eve had not sinned, that we would have forever the Garden of Eden? But when they sinned, it affected the earth. That's why the earth is in the mess it's in. But guess what? We're going back. We're going back, and I praise God. He's Almighty God. 57 times in the Word, God is described as Almighty. Psalms 24:8. Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, invincible in battle. Job said, I know that you can do anything and that no one can stop you. Jeremiah said in Jeremiah 32, O sovereign Lord, you made the heavens and earth by your strong hand and powerful arm. Nothing is too hard for you. Oh, glory to God. And Ephesians 3, I love this. You know, he says, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you can even ask or think about.
Amen.
You think you're asking a lot, and the Lord says, is that all you got?
Well.
Is that the top of your thought?
Well.
Is that the best you can do? Really? Wow. That same God, remember, turned a 99-year-old into a dad and a 90-year-old into a mother. He took 2 or 3 million slaves to a dry desert on the shores of the Red Sea and then used that same sea to drown the army that was after him. Those are just a few. We could stay all day long naming all the things that God has done. But even though nothing is impossible with God, does that mean that God can do anything?
No.
No, he can't do anything. He has limited himself. Certain things he can't do. For starters, he said he can't lie.
Amen.
Hebrews 6:18. So God has given both his promise and his oath. These two things are unchangeable because it is impossible for God to lie. Therefore, we who have fled to him for refuge can have great confidence as we hold to the hope that lies before us. Okay, so God can do anything. He can do anything except by his own choice.
Right.
He cannot lie.
Right.
He can't wink at sin either. And he cannot be tempted by evil.
Amen.
David keeps pondering God's creation of human beings. He's amazed how God accomplished man's creation, not in some kind of generalized way, but personally to him. And you see it in Psalms 139:15. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. There's not any person who's ever lived, that God was not there.
Right.
And that God did not form them. Before you were fully formed, before you were a complete fetus, God was watching you. And he's been watching you your entire life.
Right.
You didn't evolve from something else. You were made. You were formed, you were fashioned by the hand of God.
Amen.
Then the third thing, God's work was comprehensive. He took his time as he formed you. He didn't rush. He decided that it's going to take 9 months in your mother's womb for you to be ready to be born. During those 9 months, what was God doing? He was writing your story. Now, what I'm saying here, God was involved in your life because your story was written. He was just involved in your life. He was overseeing it. David said in 139:16, you saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. Wow. You know, I think the greatest thing you and I could do right now, Lord, help me finish this race by being on the same page that you're on.
Yes.
He had a perfect plan for your life and filled with blessings. That's what he did. He determined the number of your days and the very moment he determined when you would return to him, unless you choose otherwise. And having done every bit of that, then God took a risk.
Yeah.
He gave you free will. To choose, you could either choose everything he's ever prepared for you, or you can reject him and just do your own thing. 139 verses 17 to 18. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God? They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. Just tell me how much God's thinking about you right now as you sit in here. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand. Give me a break. And when I wake up, you're still with me. Now, there's two very important statements here, and I don't want you to miss them. Number one, God's thoughts about you, they're precious. They're good. They're wonderful thoughts. He adores you. He loves you with an extravagant, powerful love. And he thinks good things. God does not think bad things about you. He loves you. He's not mad with you. He thinks of you so much that there's no way any one of us could count how many times God thinks about us. I'm talking about on a daily basis. How can he do that? I don't know how he can do that. He's the Almighty God. All I know is he can do it. He says, my God thinks of me on a scale that is so far beyond me that I have no way to measure how much my God thinks of me. His thoughts toward me are even more numerous than all the grains of sand on every beach throughout the entire world.
Wow.
Whew, that's a lot of sand, church. What a God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. How then, in closing, how then should we think about ourselves, about our brothers and our sisters? Philippians 4. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what's true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent, things that are worthy of praise. And Peter puts it this way in 1 Peter. So prepare your mind for action and exercise self-control. Put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. Church, we are not what we eat. We're what we think about what God thinks about us.